Thank you, Mr. Deora, for joining us. We have a very eclectic audience here that's been engaging very actively with us. We've already had two critical discussions, one on future of work, jobs, unemployment, and so on. And the other that you just saw on the state of education in India. And of course, you've been very involved with young people, as a union minister earlier yourself. And otherwise as well, I remember you also started a campaign called Youth Speak, where you directly tried to engage with young people, heard directly from them, and you've been very proactive in listening to and communicating with young people. So the idea behind this discussion really is that we, of course, talk about a couple of key issues, but we really open the floor to the audience to directly ask you, what their concerns are, what they want answered, and so on. So
let me just start by firstly congratulating ORF, Youth Ki Awaaz, and Twitter for putting together this event. And it's great to see my dear friend Hima Bagla, the very dynamic principal of KC College. And it's always a pleasure to meet students of Mumbai and to understand from them what their aspirations are, what their concerns are. And I came in before and heard the earlier panel talking about what they want the most from a college, from hygienic toilets to, quality teaching. And I'm glad that this event is giving the youth a platform to voice issues that really matter to them. Because unfortunately, the political discourse in our country tends to move away from actual developmental issues to more emotional issues of religion and caste and things like that. But what really affects the youth of India today are issues that I heard earlier. So congratulations to each and every one of the youth who are present here today. The future is really in your hands. No political party and no politician can ignore the youth vote. So how you vote will set the agenda for us as politicians and political parties in the coming elections. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Deora. Please, a big round of applause for Mr. Deora. So just to kick off the discussion, you just mentioned that, no political party can really ignore what young people have to say. But at the same time, while in the last elections, the voting percentage of young people was fairly high, it was around 60% first-time voters, but there's still a sizable chunk of young people that do not go out to actually vote. There is a feeling that their voices are not being heard. There is a feeling that, the participation is low. So why do you think is it critical for young people to really be involved in this conversation? And what do you think political parties can do a lot more that they're not doing right now to listen to young people?
I think to start with, the youth vote is very, very important. I got into politics in 2004. It's been 15 years. And I've seen that every generation of young voters thinks the same thing. That can I make a difference? Does my vote really count? And I really believe that each generation has to understand that you have more power than any other community, any other section of voters in this country. And this is true in any democracy, not just in India. It could be true of the United States as well. And therefore, getting young people to come out and vote in large numbers is of extreme importance. Today, let me ask all the young minds present here today, how many of you know whether you're registered to vote or not? So there's about 50% of you who are saying you are fully aware that you're registered. Also, some of the hands went up very slowly, which means you're probably not too sure. And I would say that's the first start. The first start for you to be active in politics and for you to have your voice heard. And as I said, to set the agenda, which is most important, is for you to know whether you are registered to vote or not. The second part is to come out and vote in large numbers. So luckily, the process with the Election Commission to get yourselves registered is underway right now. Please do that. For those of you whose hands didn't go up, please do that. For those of you whose hands went up very slowly, please check again if your name is registered or not. I think the second big issue is, how do you vote? Just voting is not enough. So I think for a long time, various campaigns by NGOs and non-political organizations have said young people should vote, they should vote. And I really believe that voting is very, very critical, but how you vote is also very important. How often do you look at a candidate? How often do you ignore a candidate's background? That's very, very critical. Many people sometimes say, you don't even know if your candidate or the person representing you, if they have a criminal background. You don't know what the educational qualifications of a candidate are. You don't know what their assets and liabilities are. All of this information is in the public domain. Every time I fight an election, I have to disclose to the public in an affidavit, in a signed affidavit, what is my criminal record. But very rarely do politicians get asked that question by young voters as to why do you have a criminal record. Fortunately, I don't have a criminal record. But there are many candidates who pass elections and win handsomely in spite of having these records. So I think getting young people to vote is one part of the problem. But getting young people to vote correctly on issues that matter to them and for the right people is equally critical. Because if you just have young people voting in large numbers, but they're getting swayed by emotional issues, then it's not helpful for the democracy. In fact, it's more harmful for the country and for the country's development.
You mentioned about, you know, issues, but before that, you know, I just have a quick question, which is that you also said that young people, you know, should communicate directly with the government. They should make their voices heard. So in the last, and you know, we actually have a panel on this shortly after this as well. In the last couple of months and years, we've seen that while many young people are speaking out, they're definitely, you know, coming out and talking about issues, there is a feeling that maybe the space to directly communicate with political leaders, decision makers is not there, or is, you know, not really as powerful or as enabling as it should be. Is it something that you've also noticed when it comes to young people? And how do you think can young people really enable that space to directly communicate with political leaders and, you know, make their voices heard?
I think that the space, in fact, has widened in the last few years. It has. I differ with you. I think it hasn't shrunk, it's widened. When I got into politics in 2004, the only way somebody could talk to me was if they physically met me in my office or if they wrote me a letter or an email. Today, you can connect with me on Twitter, you can connect with me on Facebook, you can connect with me on social media. So in fact, the space to directly engage with politicians has widened and become much more easier than it was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Today, you have politicians, ministers who can't ignore what people are saying on social media. They have to respond. Why only politicians? Even ministers. Even ministers of different governments, government of India, government of different states, have to respond to what's out there on social media. So I believe right now we live in such a democratized world where through social media, through right to information, through voting rights to people above the age of 18 years of age, there is no reason why young people cannot get more engaged. In fact, the government and successive governments over the decades have done a very good job of opening up government to the public. When right to information was enacted in Parliament in 2005, I had the opportunity to initiate the debate in the Lok Sabha on the right to information bill, which is on YouTube. And I remember speaking about that. I actually said in my speech that right to information will not only make governments more transparent, more accessible to the people, but at some level, it is also reducing the role of elected representatives. Because now voters and citizens can interact directly with the government and they don't need necessarily their representative to represent them and to communicate with the government. Because representative democracy is an idea which, of course, started many, many centuries ago, but it's an idea where with technology, things are beginning to change. What does a representative mean anymore? A representative existed in a day and age when you didn't have social media, you didn't have television media, when you needed your representative to raise your voice and your concern in that parliament in that particular country or state. Today, your voice can be heard directly. So I'm not saying you need to do away with parliament or you need to do away with assemblies. But what I'm saying is power has come in the hands of people today. And I really think it's a very exciting time in governance. It's a very exciting time in politics all over the world, in any democracy. Because today, information has become so democratized and so open that in real time, we can have a conversation like we're having here physically. We don't even need to be here physically. You could be at your home and having this conversation with me. I could be in my office and having this conversation with you. And that's the way the world is moving. And that's the way governance is moving. When I was a minister of telecommunications and IT, I was in charge of a project called NEGP, which is a national e-governance plan. And we implemented this across the country. And I used to always say, when people used to talk about corruption, and they used to say, someone would say, we need Lokpal, we need this, we need that. I would always tell people the best way to fight corruption and to reduce corruption is to reduce the interface between the citizen and government. If a citizen needs a service from the government, let's say you need to go and get your driver's license, but you don't have to deal with somebody in the RTO office. You can do it online. You can do it through e-governance. Automatically, you're eliminating the need for corruption. When you have to deal with three people, four people along the way, you pay one person, you have to pay another person, that person will not process your application till you pay them. So technology is a tool which is changing governance. It's impacting the way governments think, it's impacting the way political parties think, it's impacting the way parliaments function all over the world, and it's impacting the way voters and politicians interact with one another. So I see no reason why young people should be cynical about their voice being heard. When I was a young person and I was your age, 18 years, 19 years, 20 years, 21 years of age, I also felt very cynical. I also felt my voice doesn't matter. But when I'm looking at all of you in the audience today, that wasn't me. And I'm seeing so many of you here, I'm looking at you collectively as a voice. I'm looking at all of you collectively as the youth of Mumbai, as the youth of India. So when you're looking at yourself, you're not alone. You have a very important voice. And it's very, very, very important for that voice to be heard.
So Mr. Dore, you also mentioned that, you know, there are, I mean, while young people need to go out and vote, it's very important to not get, you know, swayed by emotions. It's important to vote on key issues that really matter to young people. So today, I mean, just before your... you know, this discussion, we discussed about jobs, we discussed about education, but what do you think are the, you know, two or three key issues that are really pertinent for young people to consider when they go out to vote, and that may not be getting highlighted as much in the media or as much as, you know, as they should be in social media conversations as well?
Let me answer it with a counterpoint that you're asking me, what do I think are issues that young people should be concerned about? I'll tell you what I think are issues young people should not be concerned about. They should not be concerned whether a temple is built or a mosque is built in Ayodhya, number one. What is of utmost importance to them is, will I get a job? What is the state of the economy today? What is our foreign policy today? Which direction are we going in our foreign policy? What is the state of our education today? What is the state of public hospitals and public healthcare today? Those are the issues that matter. What is the state of Mumbai city today? What is the state of our roads? What is the state of the water in my building? Am I getting water? Am I depending on tankers for water? Those are the issues that impact each and every one of us on a daily basis, not emotional issues. So what are the issues that impact you and you should be thinking about? Honestly, you know better than I do. I'm here to hear from you. What are the issues? I will not want to impose what I think are issues to you. But I certainly believe in the area of the economy, in the area of jobs. As a policymaker and a politician, I'm extremely concerned about the health of our economy going forward. And this has nothing to do with government A or government B, or party A or party B. I think India has a serious problem in terms of being able to create jobs, regardless of which party is in power. We are not able to create jobs as quickly as China. In the technology space, we've lost out to countries like the US or Israel in terms of innovation. Now, I see no reason why a company like WhatsApp or a service like WhatsApp, which we all use, should not have been created in India. India's engineers in Silicon Valley, in San Francisco, in California, in the United States, are creating WhatsApp. They are creating companies like Google. They are creating companies like Facebook. They are creating companies like Apple. They are creating companies like Ola. They are creating companies like Tesla, which are the companies of the future. They are the most valuable companies in the world today. And when I talk to people as a former IT minister in the government of India, when I spoke to people in Silicon Valley, and I asked them, what sets you apart from a country like India? We have infrastructure. We have telecommunication infrastructure. We have 4G. We have fiber. optic connectivity, high-speed broadband connections. We have the best human resources and the best talent. Why are we fundamentally different from you? And the answer I got from some of the top CEOs of these companies was that we have a different culture which creates innovation and enables innovation. And I asked them, can you please define what do you mean by culture? And they broke it up into two things. They said, number one, we as a society, and Silicon Valley in particular, where all these companies have been founded and are headquartered, we embrace and encourage intelligent failure. What that means is, if you think of an idea of a startup, but that idea fails, but you've gone out and taken a loan from a bank, you've got an investor who's invested in your company, but that idea fails, there's no stigma attached to you having failed. You are in fact encouraged that you failed, you tried and failed. That means you have good experience. The next time you will be successful. So an investor will say, you tried and failed. That means the next time I think you'll be successful, I'm going to invest in your company. In India, we have a culture which is, if you failed once, if you failed in school, if you failed in class, if you failed in your home, if you failed in sports, if you failed in startup and business, that means you're a failure for life. Yeah. And that's a culture which we need to change. The second big thing they told me, how they define culture and how they differentiate, is they said, in Silicon Valley, whether it's at a Uber, whether it's at an Apple, whether it's at a Google, whether it's at a Facebook, we don't care if you are a man or a woman. We don't care which country you've come from. We don't care which language you speak. We don't care what the color of your skin is. We don't care what your religion is. We look at you based on your ability to innovate and your ability to think out of the box. And that's another problem in our country. That in India, so much of innovation is hindered and constrained because of how we think. So sometimes, I mean, now, you know, moving into the political space, sometimes when we talk of the word, you know, secularism, people think of secularism as only a humanitarian issue. Oh, you should respect minorities. It's humanitarian, right? It's beyond humanitarian. It's actually in our economic interest to preach secularism. It's in our national interest to preach secularism. It creates a culture of innovation indirectly. So these are the challenges I think that are important to the youth of Mumbai, the youth of India today. And I really feel that if some of these young boys and girls present here today, I feel there's no reason why we can't create the companies of the future right here in Mumbai or in Bengaluru or wherever else. But the only things that are constraining them is the culture. And unfortunately, society, which means politicians, political parties, sometimes your family, sometimes your school, sometimes your teachers, they are restricting you to think beyond a certain way. And it's important for you as young people to break away from that. Because today, the biggest challenge to me is not jobs in India, but jobs globally. Because you are not competing with another Indian in Jharkhand or in Delhi for a job. You are competing with an Indian in New York City and London for a job also. That's how globalized the world is. So for you to outcompete them and to be successful, you have to think in the way that they are thinking. You have to embrace a culture which is open, transparent, liberal.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Deora. On that note, we'll open up the floor to audience questions.